an exciting time to be here in this world. Of all the times we could have been here, the human history is about 7,000 years, roughly, recorded history. Of all the times we're here, it's 2020, and we're here on the face of the earth at this time. Why God chose us, each one in this room, to be here at this time, we don't know, but we're here. And we do with what God has given to us. What we're going to look at today, we're continuing in our study of 1 Peter, 1 Peter chapter 3, and this was written about 2,000 years ago, and the challenges that were there at that time to the people there, in the congregation, congregations, plural, for us. How do we apply that? Different time, different season, different things. Now, last week, my wife was to go up to from 8 to 13, but she only went to 12. And some of our English translations, or depending on what Bible you have, break it off into different places. My Bible ends it up in verse 12, closes it off, starts with verse 13 on a new paragraph. And so we're going to do that because she didn't do it that verse, and so we'll tie that in. It's actually an introduction to the next phase, what we're talking about here, the next paragraph. So, in 1 Peter chapter 3, someone please read for us 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 13 to 22. 13 to 22. Someone, there we go, thank you.
1 Peter chapter 3, verses 13 to 22. And who is he who will harm you if you become followers of what is good? But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you are blessed. And do not be afraid of their threats, nor be troubled, but sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you with meekness and fear, having a good conscience, that when they defame you as evildoers, those who revile your good conduct in Christ may be ashamed. For it is better, if it is the will of God, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive by the Spirit, by whom also he went and preached the spirits in prison, who formerly were disobedient, when once the divine long-suffering waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is, eight souls were saved through water. There is also an antitype which now saves us, baptism, not the removal of the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience toward God, through good conscience, through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, angels and authorities and powers having been made subject to him.
Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you what you have given to the early churches then, and we are here today, here in Kuwait. We take your word. Attune our ears now, Father, I pray to you. Help me to speak your words only. Give us ears to hear what you're saying to us. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Well, verse 13 starts off with the statement. I'm going to take it from the Berean literal translation. And who is he who will harm you if you should be zealous for that which is good? It's a simple question. It's asking a question, and to which an answer needs to be given. And I think an easier way to ask ourselves the question is to put it into the context of a home. And if we put it into the context of a home, then it might make a little bit more sense. So let's do it this way. Parents are going to go out for the day, and they're leaving their kids at home, and they're giving their kids some instructions as to what to do. Okay, and so please do this and that and the other thing, and of course it's going to be a list of chores. What kid likes chores? You want to go out and play. So anyways, the parents go, and lo and behold, one of them says, "Let's do what mommy says to do." Okay? There's an eager enthusiasm to do it. And the question is, and who is he who will harm you if you should be zealous for doing that what is good? So which of the other siblings is going to harm the one who wants to do good? And I hope the answer is none. But it does happen on occasion where one of them may have a different agenda. Maybe a friend comes along and wants to play, and then the older brother and sister says, no, you can't play because mom and dad said you're supposed to do it, and that and that. Things go on and on. And all of a sudden, things get a little bit tussly, and maybe some arms fly or fists fly. Things don't look good. And before you know it, there's someone who's doing harm to the one who's zealous to do good. Why does the one do harm to the one who's zealous to do good? Because they have a different agenda. A different agenda to that what is good. Now that's in a home setting. That can sometimes happen that way, and it answers a simple question. Who wants to harm you if you're doing good? The only ones who want to harm you if you're doing good is someone who doesn't want to do good or wants to do their own thing. Now put this into the context of our following Jesus Christ. Who would want to harm you if you're doing what God wants you to do? Well, it's those who don't want to do what God wants to do. Very simple. It's not a very complicated thing. Now, please keep in mind the context of who's writing this and to whom he's writing. This is Peter, okay, may be in jail, may not be in jail. Half the time looks like what Paul's writing or Peter or the other guys, they're sitting in jail. And they're writing to a church which is facing opposition. They're facing persecution. They're facing items of despair. Now, here's what goes on. When Peter's writing this, when Paul's writing their stuff, it's in the context of the government watching over what they're doing. And so if Peter's going to be writing this, or when Paul writes his letters, or the others write it in jail, it's going to pass by the eyes of the jail keeper. Now, if you're going to make an accusation against the jail keeper, that's not a good idea if you're already in jail. Not a good idea, okay? So you can say what you want to say, but you got to put it into a Morse code of your own and put it in a rhetorical question. Who's going to harm you at that time? The government's going to harm you. The government, the jailkeeper, and his bosses are going to harm you if you're doing good. Why? Because they're preaching that Jesus is Lord. And as far as the jailkeeper and as far as the government people are concerned, Caesar is Lord. And of course, we don't promote and we don't advocate in any way violence against anyone in any form. But by saying Jesus is Lord, we invite persecution. And so he asks the question, and who will harm you if you should be zealous for that which is good? That's then. What about now? Go to the marketplace. Go to the workplace. You're pressurized to take a bribe. You're pressurized to give a bribe. Who's going to harm you if you're zealous to say no? Because if you're doing the right thing, you're going to say no. And hopefully you just don't passively say no. You're adamant. You have to be careful how you vocalize it, but you're going to be absolute, emphatic that you do not accept bribes or give bribes. You are inviting persecution. It's quiet. This is life. This is life. And so the question comes, who is he who's going to harm you if you're zealous for doing good? The answer is lots of people. Lots of people. And the ones who are the ones who don't want to do good. But sometimes and many times they don't know that it's not good. If you're raised in a society where bribery is the norm and paying people for everything is normal, you grow up and think that's absolutely normal. So there's nothing in your mind, well, there's nothing wrong with this. That's the way society works. And then someone comes along and says, well, that's not the way Christians operate. And all of a sudden you start shifting gears, you're going to have opposition. And the closer you get to Christ, the more zealous you get for the right things. And the more zealous you get for the right things, the more opposition comes. So, welcome to Christianity. A life full of suffering and persecution. But don't worry, because Jesus has overcome. And so if our eyes are on the persecution, you're looking at the wrong place. That's why our eyes are on Jesus. And when our eyes are on Jesus, those things are incidental. And the focus becomes Jesus. And that's the passage that he's looking at here consistently. He's writing all of chapter 3, all of 2, all of these things about this issue of whether it's submission or working things through. Verse 10, for he who wants to love life and see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil. So by doing certain things, we actually invite the blessings of God. I don't know about you, but I want the blessings of God. I want the bountiful fullness of life that's there. But in order to achieve that, I have to maintain certain standards to do that. And there's principles that one has to keep. And so this is what this verse, verse 13, brings this transition from the previous paragraph into verse 14. So let's go on to 14. But even if you should suffer because of righteousness, you are blessed. Oh, thank you. So it's coming. Yes, it's coming. But don't worry about it. Jesus has gone on ahead and he says, come follow me. Now, remember who wrote this. This is Peter writing this, okay? And Peter now is writing this a few decades later, but I'm sure as the Spirit was prompting him to write this to the churches, when he would have written this, because my mind did, and how much more for the author, when he's writing this, his mind would have gone back to, please turn with me, to Matthew chapter 5. And Matthew chapter 5 is the Beatitudes, that when Jesus is on the mountain. Now remember, back then Peter was still new in the faith. He's new in all of this. And what happens is he's a young disciple in Christ. And he's learning Jesus. Now he's a fisherman. He's quite raw. He's quite rough in the way he does things. And now he's left the fishing and he's following after Jesus. And Jesus comes on the scene and he says a few things which are a little hard to grasp, because as a typical laborer or workman, they generally don't take much flack from anybody. So someone strikes him on the right cheek. Hey, my friend, guess what? You're going to get one right back on the right cheek. It comes back. And so following after Jesus, he says a few things that are a bit different to the way he was raised. In Matthew chapter 5, here's what he said. Blessed and happy are those. And he starts off, for example, in verse 3, blessed are the poor in spirit. And he's like, well, why shouldn't we be rich in spirit? But we're poor in spirit. Anyways, blessed are those who mourn. Why? Well, you'll be comforted. And so he moves them on through the Beatitudes. We get to verse 10. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. You know, you read this, and now that 30 years have gone by, and Peter himself would have gone through all kinds of persecution, we have to make sure that the emphasis of Matthew is not blessed are those because of the persecution per se, but blessed are those who persevere through the persecution, because the blessing comes when you inherit the kingdom. That's where the blessing rests, right? It comes through that, but in order to get the blessing of the kingdom, you're going to have to endure some persecution. You're going to have to develop, as we say, develop the backbone, develop some strength, develop some inner character, develop godly character, develop this stuff. And so Peter would have been on that mountain listening to this stuff, and it's going through his mind and thinking, how do you do all this stuff? Well, 30 years later, he's writing it, and guess what he's saying? Blessed are you when you're persecuted. because he was being persecuted. He got it. Verse 11, back in Matthew 5, you are blessed when they insult you and persecute you, falsely say every kind of evil against you because of me. Be glad and rejoice because your reward is great in heaven, for that is how they persecuted the prophets who were before you. And I'm sure Peter would have liked to have written, blessed are those who are persecuted like the prophets before you and the apostles who are writing to you. He's speaking from experience. In fact, by now, some of his own buddies are dead. They were killed. They were martyred because of righteousness' sake. And he's still alive and he's writing this. And this is what's going on here. And so now back to our text here. This is exactly what he says. But even if you should suffer because of righteousness, you are blessed. You're happy people. Doesn't fit with our happy, clappy thinking sometimes. But it's a part and a parcel of that. And I can't really clap and be happy unless I've gone through some persecution and some of the junk has been kicked out of my life. Some of the dross and some of the wrong thinking has been cleaned. Now my hands can go up. They can go up. But when you've gone through some tough times, they go a whole lot higher with rejoicing because of the things that we've gone through. And so let's never be afraid of what comes to us. Let's persevere whatever comes to us, whatever stands God has given you at the workplace, whatever stand of righteousness, stick with the righteousness of God. Honor God and watch. God will always honor you. Amen? Never dishonor God. Never dishonor God. Honor him and he'll honor you back. 14, back to our text. 1 Peter 3:14, second part. And you should not be afraid of their threats. Should not be afraid of threats. So I looked at these two words, afraid and threats, and looked at these things to see what it was. Well, these words, both of them at the bottom of phobos, the fear, both of that comes in. But it's that picture of, we could actually rephrase this and to say that do not fear their fears. Okay, don't fear their fears. What is a fear? There's something at the origin of being afraid. There has to be a base to it. So don't fear the origin or the base of the other person's fears. Don't do that. Why does somebody persecute somebody else? Because at the base of their heart, they have some kind of a fear. Okay, if someone is perfectly relaxed and content and has no fear, they're not going to persecute anyone, right? You don't do that. If you're content with yourself and you're relaxed, nothing to fear. So who are the ones that are persecuting? And you can see that in the life of Jesus. And Peter would have seen this not only through his master, Rabbi Jesus, 3 decades ago, but he would have seen that in his own life. That there were people who were intimidated by Jesus, fearful of Jesus, had their own agendas, and it wasn't matching up, and so based on their own fears, they were persecuting Jesus. And what Peter is saying now, don't fear their fears. Don't take on their weaknesses. Don't take on their insecurities. Don't take on their ignorances and the things that they don't know what they're talking about. Leave it to them. Another way of saying it is don't be troubled by their troubles. Don't. You know, life's too short. Life's too short to pick up somebody else's trouble. If someone's got trouble, point them in the right way. Get them out of the trouble. But don't pick up their trouble. We have to learn as Christians to help people get out of their own trouble and not wallow in their troubles. Second Timothy 1:7 says this, for God did not give us a spirit of timidity, but a spirit of power, love, and of self-control. And some translations put that verse, they say, for God has not given us a spirit of fear. That's not what it says. It doesn't say fear. God has given us a spirit of, has not given us a spirit of timidity. It's different than fear. We are to fear. We're to fear God. But we're not timid. Christians should not be known as timid people. Shouldn't be. Cannot be. Sorry. It doesn't mean you have to be belligerent or boisterous and pushy. That's not what it's saying either. But for sure, not timid. Why? Because we know where we're going. We know what we're doing. You ever get lost before the GPS days? You get lost and you ask someone, how do I get to so-and-so? Well, if the person asks in a frame of timidity, I don't want that guy's advice. I want to talk to someone who said, no, I just came from there. It's right over here. Just go around the corner, turn left, and you'll see it right there. That's the guy I want to talk to, someone who's just been there, someone who's with confidence can say where they're going. God has not given us a spirit of timidity. We do know what we're talking about. We should know what we're talking about. And because of that, we can help people find the way to Jesus Christ. We're not troubled people. Amen? Well, one amen. We're not troubled people. We shouldn't be troubled. And if we have troubles, get rid of the troubles. Turn it over to Jesus, and he'll let us live in the confidence, his confidence. For he gives us a spirit of power, love, and of self-control. The verse back to our text in 3:14, the last part of it says, neither should you be troubled. Like, it's like, okay, Peter, how many different ways can you say this? And he's making a point. Because if we remember who Peter was, he's the kind of guy that jumps out of boats, okay, when Jesus says, come. He's the kind of guy that rushes into all kinds of things. That's who he is. And he's had his knocks along the life. And you say, well, how does this work for him? It's not just his experience, but it's also his theology, his practice. All people at that time based their scriptures was the Old Testament. Okay, that's what they had. So therefore, let's take a look at Isaiah. Isaiah 8:12, I put it on top here for you. Do not call conspiracy everything that people regard as conspiracy. Do not fear what they fear. Do not live in dread. The Lord of hosts is the one you are to regard as holy. Only he should be feared. Only he should be dreaded. And when you look at this thing, all of what we're saying here, all of what Peter is saying back in our text, this whole context here is that of being people who persevere during persecution. And we in Kuwait, compared to some of our neighboring countries, haven't got a clue what persecution is about. Just the other day, I'm on the phone. I'm talking to someone from one of the neighboring countries, not there now, but he was just there. And the persecution he went through, massive interrogations and all kinds of stuff that goes on. Why? Because of his faith in Christ Jesus. Here in Kuwait, who bothers us? We can preach the gospel, we can sing, we can do whatever we want. We've got absolute freedom. So where does persecution comes? Just raise a standard. Raise a standard of righteousness. Raise a standard of integrity in the midst of marketplace, day-to-day living, and watch the opposition come. Back in Isaiah's time, people were saying, oh, the Assyrians are coming. They're coming from the north. They're coming this. There's rumor. There's wars and rumors of wars, etc. And the prophet speaks the voice of God, and he says to the people, do not call conspiracy everything that these people are calling conspiracy. Can you imagine the rumors and the gossip back then without cell phones? Someone's carrying some news. Oh, these people are coming. They're big. They're strong. They're mighty military. They're wiping out one nation after another, and they start spreading fear, and all the people's hearts begin to melt like wax. And so God raises up the prophets and says, don't listen to all that garbage. God says, I've given you my word. Go back to my word, and I'll tell you how to live. And if you live the way I tell you to live, you'll succeed. And don't worry about the enemies. Don't fear what man fears. Fear God. And when you fear God, everything else falls into place. Now, what's another... So that's the Old Testament. We'll jump now to the New Testament. Please turn with me to John. John chapter 14. This is a tremendous chapter of Jesus speaking tremendous truth here along this line. And remember, Peter would have been there. He would have heard it from the lips of Jesus himself. In John chapter 14, he's talking there in verse 1. Don't let your heart be troubled. Remember what he said? Don't pick up the troubles of others. Don't be troubled by the troubles of others. Here Jesus says, don't let your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If not, I would have told you. I am going away to prepare a place for you. And he gives them the word of encouragement. Stick with the words of Jesus. When we stick with the words of Jesus, our hearts will not be troubled. They won't be. They won't be. Because we're people of faith. And what is faith? Faith is relationship with God. Faith is communion with God. Faith is obedience to God. But when we disobey God, we're not in a relationship with God. The friendship with God is deteriorating or waxing. And then all of a sudden the voices of others get louder and fear comes in. And paranoia comes in and doubt comes in. And all this kind of stuff comes in. And Peter's saying, don't operate like this. Jesus said that at that time. The way to the Father is through faith. Now, chapter 14, a tremendous chapter on the workings of the Holy Spirit and the purpose of the Holy Spirit. The Counselor has come. He's come to help us, the Spirit of Truth. That's what the meat and the sandwich of John 14 is. Now, the chapter ends in chapter 14. It's repeated in verse 27. You have your Bible still there? Look at verse 27, John 14. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give it as the world gives. Don't let your heart be troubled or fearful. Wow. You know, sometimes, you know, we get news. Life is going on well. Everything is going on fine. You're on top of the world. Things are great. You get one phone call, one text that could potentially change your life. Okay? Maybe a medical report that comes back. Maybe a report of your financial base being totally wiped away. Maybe of a loved one who died. It's amazing how even one sentence could potentially alter. Except for one thing. Where's your faith? Who's leading your future? Does that can really one sentence alter your life if it's not of God? What's the base of our news? And when we hang on to the words of God and we hold the words of God as truth and as absolute, we can endure masses of information, whether they're good to our ears or not good to our ears, and we just persevere on. We just keep moving on. Life goes on. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Never allow news to trouble your heart. Because if our hearts are based on the Word of God, we will live in a different dimension. We'll live in the heavenlies where we are supposed to live, according to Ephesians. We are living, ruling, and reigning with Christ Jesus in the heavenly realms. We go back now to our text in verse 15. But in your hearts, sanctify Christ as Lord, always ready for defense to everyone asking you for an account concerning the hope in you. A couple of words here to look at for defense. And sometimes we have to learn this. It's not so much an issue of being defensive, but rather to give a defense. In other words, respond. Think of a football game, okay? A football game. The offensive team is kicking the ball into your zone, right? Well, what are you supposed to do? That's why you have defense. Get the ball, defense, and kick it back to your own offense and get the ball going that way. That's what we do. It's not a matter of intimidation or whatever. No, it's just that's your job. And that's what we do as Christians. Be ready to give in a defense. When someone asks us about our faith, we answer. And we're not scared. We're not shy. We're not intimidated. Nothing happens. Someone asks you about your faith. That's who I am. I'm a Christian. I'm a follower of Christ Jesus. And then, okay, and then, I like the other word, asking you for an account. I took a small course in accounting years ago, as in high school. So it's of the yesteryears, of some time ago. But I just there's principles in accounting that I just enjoyed it. I liked it. Why? Because there's order to it. There's order. It's very simple. And in order to make proper accounting, there has to be order. And if you're disorderly, accounting won't work. Okay? Accounting only works, financial account only works if there's order. Okay? And the rules are quite simple. In fact, there's only one rule in accounting, only one rule. You remember this rule? You understand counting. Credit equals debit. Always. Simple. You don't have to be too intelligent to figure that out. Give an account. Now, can you imagine you're setting up a business and you got someone there running the business and stock comes and goes and then you ask the person to give an account. Okay, now if they just come and they start talking this or that and the other thing, it's like, I don't want to hear, I want to see the facts. I want to see the facts. How much was purchased? How much was sold? What's the cost? What's the markup? What's our profit? What do we have? Does it tally? Great. Where do we move on from here? We know that in the financial world, but how much more in the spirit world? Someone comes to you and asks about your faith. Can we give an account? And we all start off with what? We start off with a debit. All of us. We're in debt. I owed a debt I could not pay. He paid a debt he did not owe. I needed someone to take my sins away. You know that song? It's a very simple song. So we start off in debt. All of us start off in debt. We're born in sin, in iniquity. And we give an account. My heart was hostile towards God. And we can list off all of our debts. But praise God, it doesn't stop there. As we explain salvation, it's a balance sheet. And we begin to explain the credits. But this man of Galilee, the Son of God, died for my sins. He took my sins. He took my debts. He took them over. And he took them to the cross. He was innocent, but he died. And now I'm set free. Well, if we were to stop it there, that would just bring us to a zero balance. But then because we're giving an account, we start now adding the credits. What has he done since then? And before you know it, we show a balance sheet which shows a surplus. Amen? We live an abundant life. John 10:10, Jesus says, I've come that you have life and have life abundantly, an overflowing life. That's what we're called to live in. And so when we show our balance sheet in the spirit, we just focus in on the credits. And we see that, and we can point out, yes, and this is what it says, always in, but in your heart, sanctify Christ as Lord, always ready for a defense to everyone asking you for an account concerning the hope in you. And when the government comes to a company and asks for it, they shove their auditor, you speak to the government, revenue services, and what does the auditor do? He does exactly this stuff. He gives them a defense. He doesn't have to be defensive, but he has his act together. He shows it. This is what happened. This is the way things go. And then if it's in order, if everything's good, the guy goes, great, fine, check. But if it's not, then you got problems. Let's put that now into our spiritual life. And that's the same way. Because we will be asked on a daily basis to give an account for the hope that's in us. And can we articulate it? Can we state what our debits were, what our credits are, and what our balance sheet is, and that we're living in a state of surplus, and we have life and abundance, and we tell them, I can share that with you now. Let me introduce you the one who will set you free as well, so you can live over and above the circumstances, so that the person that you're working with doesn't have to be troubled by the troubles that constantly trouble him. Let's go on. Verse still in 15, yet with gentleness do so, in gentleness and fear, 16, having a good conscience, so that in the case that they might speak against you, those reviling your good manner of life in Christ Jesus, that they will be ashamed. When someone accuses you of something, let's say it's in the business world, and they're accusing you, all you need to do is hold up your balance sheet and say, look, it's all here, I got the supporting documents, it's all here. What happens? That person is ashamed because they spoke against something they didn't know. In the spirit, it's the same way. At work, it's the same way. All kinds of accusations can go. Who will accuse you if you're trying to do right? Lots of people. It's the ones who are doing wrong. Well, let them be ashamed. Why should you be ashamed? You just keep doing the right thing. We do the right thing. And then in the time, it will surface and the right things will begin to happen. This is what he is talking about here. How many of you have read Watchman Nee? Anybody? One person. One? That's it? Watchman Nee? Okay. I'd encourage you. I don't know if we have them in our book. I think the next slide, we've got a picture of that. He is born 1903 and was killed in 1972. He was a man of tremendous integrity. His context was in communist China at first, being raised under a relative free system, but then as communism came in and started squashing a very heavy attack against the church, and a lot of the opposition came not just from the government, but also from believers, so-called fellow believers, coming against him because of the freedom and the simplicity that he understood about the walk in Christ. And he would stand on that. And many accusations that came to him, and at one time even his wife said, why don't you try to defend yourself? And he says, he understood something. He says, God's my defense. And he lived a life of integrity, and God came through on his defense. Well, then you might say, well, then why did he die? Well, read Hebrews 11. Hebrews 11 talks about the heroes of faith. And not all of them got out of the lion's den alive. But they were still commended for their faith. Why? Because they did the right thing. You see, our righteousness can only be right if God says it's right. Our righteousness is not necessarily right if others say it's right. Our value system is not in other people's judgment, but in God's judgment. And when God says you're right, then you're right. That's full stop. That's why we fear God and only God. And so this man spent the last 20 years of his life in prison, and they actually killed him there at that time for his stand. But the works that he wrote and some of the concepts and the things that he was putting through was the simplicity of the gospel and the simplicity of gathering together as believers in Christ Jesus to walk in freedom. And so here's this guy sitting in jail, and he's actually more free than people who are out there. Why? Because the people who are out there trying to please the government so they don't get into jail were in more bondage than him. And so we can live in freedom this way. I need to move on. Verse 17, for it is better to suffer for doing good than doing evil. I've left out a section. It is better to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. That's the no-brainer. There's a little clause in the middle. If the will of God wills it, okay? God runs our life. Read Hebrews. In the morning, on Friday mornings, I'm teaching this class on faith, and I'm amazed. I'm learning so much out of it on the life of faith in the Hebrews, chapter of these great heroes, and God wills what he wills, and he'll do it. It's our job just simply to be obedient to him. And it's up to him. But in any case, what Peter's saying, it is better to suffer for doing good than it is for doing evil. So if life has its sufferings, so you might as well do the right thing. Always. Always choose the right thing. And then if you suffer for it, watch God empower you. Because if you do the wrong thing, God's not going to empower us. And then we're going to get nailed. Okay? From both ends, from peers and from God. So do the right thing. That's what Peter's saying, very simply. So I looked up this word suffer. What does it mean to suffer? Because sometimes we get a misconception on this. Okay? Suffer, the word actually just simply means there's an act upon you. Okay? An act upon you. Now, it could be good or bad. In fact, the old King James uses this word, and it's sort of like I could never understand it as a kid, where Jesus says, you know, suffer not the little children to come to me, right? And I thought, well, suffer, just a minute, because in our context, that's almost always negative. Well, it's not. The word suffer means you do an act, and there will be an act coming upon you. Now, unfortunately, in our English, we generally, it tends towards evil, because sin, humanity, our hearts are inclined towards evil. But when we do the right things, the right will come upon us. Maybe not from man, but from God. Okay? He will do it. So the point is, let's do the right things. Let's do the right things. Get the validation from God. Get the approval of God. And don't worry about anything else. Okay? Verse 18. Because Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteousness for the unrighteous, so that he might bring you to God. This brings me to Colossians 1:21. I've got it on here. This includes you who were once far away from God and were his enemies, separated from him by your evil thoughts and actions. And maybe someone says, well, I've been born and raised in church. I don't have evil thoughts or actions towards God. Sorry, yes, you do. Yes, you do. All of us did. All of us did. When we're not born again, our hearts are inclined towards evil because we're born in sin. And sometimes we classify sin as being something, you know, the murder, the adultery, and all the big things that man labels as big. But a simple thing like disobedience, not doing the will of God, is sin. And that's hostility towards God. And God demands complete obedience. And he rewards complete obedience. And we can only experience the fullness of life if we have full obedience to God in all areas of life. Ephesians 2:13 puts it this way, but now you have been united with Christ since you were once far away from God, but now you have been brought near to him through the blood of Christ. Having been brought near to Christ, close to him, we begin to understand him. You know, sometimes you may not understand somebody's action. You go, why did that person ever do that? And then by chance one day, maybe it's at work, maybe it's some colleague or someone in a different department, and they're doing something. You're like, are you serious? Why is that guy doing it? And did nothing make sense, and everyone's gossiping and making, you know, fun of this, why it doesn't make sense. And one day, by chance, maybe you have lunch with that person or see them in the parking lot, and you start talking, and you begin to understand why they did it and their rationale, because from where they are, they stand in a different position than you, and they see things differently, and all of a sudden you get it, and it makes sense, and their decision is actually, yeah, that was the right thing to do. What made the change? Your relationship with that person. That's all. Nothing changed. That person didn't change his mind. Nothing changed with you. It's just other than you see what that person sees. And this is what God is calling us to do. He's calling us to come close to him, and this is what Christ did. Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to us. This is the whole provision, having been put in Ephesians. You have been united with Christ. Once you were far away from God, but now you've been brought near to God through the blood of Christ Jesus. And when we're brought near to God, we begin to see things the way God sees it. And then things begin to make sense for us. Need to close off here. Having been put to death indeed the flesh, but having been made alive in the spirit, verse 19, in which also having gone, he preached to the spirits in prison, at one time having disobeyed. Serious, big time understatement. At one time, man, they were all disobeying God. Ask Noah, right? The entire world at that time was disobeying. And so what does God do? Talks to Noah, has a chat with him because Noah is walking close with God. He hears God. He does what God tells him to do. He takes his family, puts them into the boat. The water comes, and he's baptized, so to say. Well, what's the deal? Is water cleansing him? No. That's what Peter says later. No, it's not that. It's his faith in God. And the fact that he got into the ark, and the ark was the salvation for him that comes across. And so Peter puts this across here, verse continuing in our text. When the long-suffering of God was awaiting in the days of Noah, the ark being prepared, in which a few, that is eight souls, were saved through this water, which also prefigures the baptism now saving you, not a putting away of the filth of the flesh, in other words, not just the washing, but the demand of a good conscience towards God, meaning obeying God, doing God. Can you imagine if Noah wouldn't have done that? He'd have never been saved. Okay? Never. It wouldn't have happened. And this happens now through the resurrection of Christ Jesus, who is at the right hand of God, having gone into the heavens, angels and authorities and powers having been subjected to him. We know a whole lot more than Noah did, a lot more. But Noah knew this one thing. He knew how to listen to God. And so we're called to listen to God. Listen to God, walk with God, stick with God, walk in His ways, walk His clothes, and watch everything come into place. And God empowers us. How else can we picture it? If we see God the Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, all-knowing, all-powerful, and we walk with Him, who can attack? Who can say something against? Coming back to the very opening verse that we had in the chapter, and this is what Peter, or in this paragraph, who is it who will harm you if you should be zealous for doing good? You know, and it's again coming back to the kids in the home. So you left the home and the kids did their shenanigans, and one of them did what you asked them to do, okay? And the parents come back, and doesn't matter what kind of fight happened before, but when the parents come back, the one who did the parent's will can come up to the parent and be protected by the parent, right? Because why? They did the will and did it right. And there's a blessing and a reward that comes back on that. And this is the concept of we grow up this way, understanding that with obedience comes blessing. With obedience comes protection. With obedience comes guidance and the promotion. All these things that come along this way. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the love that you have put into our hearts, for your word, for you, for your people. And Lord, I pray in Jesus' name, just as Peter worked through all this for the generations back then, Lord, help us today to take these words, to take this, O Lord God, and understand that your love and your grace protects, covers, guides, and overshadows us. I thank you, O Father God, for you are good. Thank you for these words that you gave. And Lord Jesus, I pray as we walk out of here today that our faith in you would have grown. Knowing, dear God, that when we simply walk in your steps, doing your will, doing your way, that we can live in the fullness of life, living, O God, to what you've called us to. We bless you, and we say thank you. Amen.